Hi, everybody.
And good evening, everyone. Welcome to Filk Quest with your host, Frank Filk Ferret Parker. And how's everybody doing tonight? Tonight we have the honor of having Margaret Davis and Kristoph Klover here with us tonight from the West Coast, on the left coast, correct?
That's right.
Yeah, what time is it out there for you guys?
Just 6:01.
Yeah. Yep.
So weather looks good out there. So what we're doing tonight, we're going to be discussing a few things with Margaret and Kristoph and see how their journey through Filk and Celtic music and things like that have gone. They've got a couple songs they've got keyed up that they want to do. They've got a couple albums and a couple other things they'd like to promote, which is really great. So let's go over a couple things for the channel. Friday night, I don't have anything set up for Critical, Not Cynical. I will have that posted tomorrow. I've got two choices that I'm thinking about doing, and I'll put that out for Friday. Saturday night, we have the last Farragut episode that we have in the queue, which is The Crossing. Now, some exciting news from Farragut is that on apparently they finally got Homecoming completed after 6 years. So October 1st, they're supposed to be premiering it. And I'm trying to find out exactly. I've got it posted on the Crossroads Facebook page and also on my my other pages. So I'll get that out for those who are into the Star Trek fan films with us as soon. And that should be it for the next couple of days. So let's see who's in tonight. Let's see. Mark Mandel. I haven't seen Mark in a long time. How you doing, buddy? Yeah, and Mark, I would like to talk to you because I would like to get you on here also. So we'll talk to you later, old buddy from Massville. He and I have known each other for quite, I think, 1998. Long time on that one. And, of course, my buddy who was on last week, Mr. Larry Kirby. How you doing, buddy? I hope your week has gone well. And then our friend Claude Sailing says, hi, all. And Robin Baylor, welcome back. How you doing, Robin?
Hi, Robin.
Okay, and let's see, Feline Quinty. Hello, how you doing tonight, Feline? And then we have Spear Carrier. Well, welcome, everybody. I'm glad that you were able to make it tonight. And
I know who Spear Carrier is.
Ah, okay. That's good. So I see we have some of your fans coming on. That's great. That's fantastic. So welcome, Margaret and Kristoph. How are you doing tonight?
Oh, we're doing good. We just got a new roof put on our house, and that's been exciting and loud for 3 days because we've been inside while they put it on.
Yeah. It's like having somebody move a refrigerator and repeatedly drop it over your head.
Over and over.
Not good. Not good. Well, I hope, was it just the shingling or did they just do the basic repair? Oh,
we have a very old house, so they had to take a whole lot of stuff down. They had to do way more than they should have had to do. But that being the case, it is now done. And I'm happy to report that Flowing Glass Studio, that is our garage, now has a real roof on it. And I'm just chuffed by that. It just makes working in the studio so much better. So
very good. So let's start off with that. I take it you guys do your own production in the garage then, and you produce your albums.
Yeah.
Yeah, Kristoph's the engineer, a professional quality engineer. He's got some incredible microphones and years and years and years and years of experience, and has produced, in addition to all of the Margaret and Kristoph CDs, Avalon Rising CDs, and Broselion CDs, a lot of other really kind of big name Filkers CDs as well. Take it away, Kristoph.
I think you threw that over my head. Whoops! I'll try to catch it. So I drive the train. Margaret tells the train where to go.
Yeah.
How's that? Nah, that's not quite true. I'm just having fun with a little metaphor there. Anyway.
That's the same person who does it to me right here. Hi, Donna. It's my wife.
Well, hello, Donna. Anyway, I think I've been very lucky to spend time with some really, really fine engineers really early on, and lucky that I was given the helm at an early time at Off Centaur way back when.
Mm-hmm.
The first Filk album that I kind of was in charge of coming up with things to go with it, backups and backgrounds and stuff. This was at Off Centaur. Was of Bill Roper.
Oh, and okay.
It was the
Grim Reaper.
The Grim Reaper.
Yeah.
The Grim Reaper.
Anyway, so and I just had a marvelous time with that. And every time I listen to that album, I just marvel at the stuff that I was able to get away with. So
we were talking about that when Bill was on a couple of weeks ago about that album, actually.
Well, there's all that oboe in there. I love the oboe bits. They just come at you. I was like, what was I thinking? It's a wall of oboe. And I had never met Bill. And then I met Bill, and I was like, well, you really do this, and I'm kind of this person on the side who doesn't really know anything about what we're doing here, but I'm certainly having fun. Nice to meet you.
That was in about 83 or so.
Yeah, 84.
Got involved in Filk in 83, so it's been a long, 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 long time now.
Yeah, but when Margaret really kind of coalesced things, when the two of us met, she and I decided we were going to really record ourselves, and we bought a Tascam 8-track. You know, not a digital items before.
Cassette.
Not cassette. No.
Cassette either?
Full on reel to reel Tascam. I don't mess around when I get into stuff. I knew what I wanted.
Yeah, and so, that to me is one of the from the reel-to-reel days, too. You can't beat them in a lot of ways.
Well, that's what Off Centaur did, too. They had Tascam reel-to-reels, too. Mine was actually a newer one and had a higher headroom range in it. And then when Ampex improved, I'm just getting off subject here. I'll stop that. Anyway, I could wax philosophical, but early on, we made the acquaintance of Cynthia McQuillan. And she then did all album after album after album with us.
Yeah.
Almost all of them done on that 8-track.
Kristoph actually engineered most of her most important albums. And actually, he produced most of them. But I produced Witch's Dance. I'm very
proud.
I produced Witch's Dance.
That's one of the best albums there is.
And we recorded most of the backups on most of Cindy's albums. Those are us playing the flute, the harp, the voices,
nice,
the guitars, the oboe, the octave mandolin. We were very, very, very close to Cindy. She was a dear, dear friend.
Yeah.
We hung out with her a whole lot, and we're so proud to have been involved in the production of so many of these albums.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. So let's go back to the beginning.
Hmm.
How long have you guys been playing? Not yourselves, but what? Okay, we'll start with Margaret. When did you start getting involved with music as music, per se?
Let's see. I started flute when I was 10. And I started recorder when I was 12. So those two have been going a really long time. I've been playing harp and singing since I was 27, so those have been going pretty darn long, too. I have a degree in music, and did my first professional gig at the age of 17. I'm very, very proud of that. I played in a symphony orchestra for 6 years, starting at the age of 17. And did classical.
Were you a harpist?
No, I was primarily a flutist in those days.
Okay.
Actually, yeah. And did classical for years and years and years and years until this was in Illinois where I grew up.
Okay.
But I came out to California to pursue graduate work, and my mind was blown. Whee! Became introduced to a lot of other music I didn't really know existed, the Celtic music and the medieval and Renaissance music. And I was like, well, you know, I like this simpler kind of modal music better than I liked most classical music. And I got all interested in that and started focusing on that.
You were in a medieval band for a while.
Yeah, starting in 86, I was in a band that did nothing but medieval music for 6 years called Guy Saber. Nobody has heard of that.
Were you SCA at the time? Are you SCA?
I was in the SCA very, very briefly. I wish I'd had time to spend more time in it.
Yeah, I got it from the Blibbering Humdingers and a couple other people that I know that are in the SCA. It is very time consuming. Sometimes I wonder... Well, I mean, it depends what your passion is. You know, you can, you know, spend a lot of time. So, Kristoph, how about you? Where did you start your love of music, and what was your journey up?
Well, you know, I don't know where to begin with that, because my family was just so very musical. Both my parents played piano. My dad was a fabulous singer. My mom was a fabulous singer. She was probably the better piano player. My dad played piano the way I kind of play piano, which is hard and loud. It's like, play quietly. That isn't something we can do. I don't know. I'm actually, as an aside, currently playing in a blues band called Bluesadelics. And Bluesadelics has a gig coming up at this weekend on Sunday in the afternoon. And I'm playing keyboard in that, and I haven't played keyboard in a band ever. So I haven't really played keyboard seriously since college, when as a music department person, you have to take piano, and I had piano lessons. And I loved that because they were so easy for me, because I'd had piano lessons when I was a kid. So, but before even that, our family sang, we would do the dishes together and sing five-part harmony. There were five of us. And we would really sing five-part harmony. And we got quite good at stuff. People would hear us and be amazed. I know when we went on vacation, my dad was a Lutheran pastor, so we had to go to church on Sundays while on vacation. Although in later years, I have to say, good for my dad. He said, you know, maybe we don't have to. It's like, great, Dad, that's so much better. But because of that, we went to church in Yosemite. There's a church in Yosemite that you can go to. It's kind of a non-denominational thing, or I think it was at the time. And we went there and we sang in the back. And the preacher came up to us and said, "Wow, we wish you would come every Sunday, because you're like the best singers we've heard in just years in here." So, but that was just how our family was. So beginning that, I don't know, I had oboe when I was around 14, something like that. I started playing oboe because my dad said to me, "Hey, play the oboe. Nobody else plays it. You'll be all alone. It'll be great. You get all these solos and stuff." And my young mind said, "Wow, playing something that nobody else plays. That'd be really cool." Old Kristoph says, "Oh, I played violin. My sister Kathy plays violin. I could have played violin. I would have much rather played violin. She had a flute for a while. I could play that when I was a kid, too. Although, I can't play flute. No, it's just not true. I just can't do it." But, so, I really enjoyed growing up with that sort of thing. And I had a musical education and did music. I sang in choirs, and my mom directed choirs, and just tons of stuff. I still play the oboe, I'm pleased to say. But oboe is amazing. It's true. I'm pleased to say I play folk oboe. Margaret came up with that, and thank goodness she did that, because I approach oboe in a very classical way, and I know that I haven't practiced or played, and my lip isn't any good. And I'm so aware of this that I can't play. So Margaret says, "It's a folk oboe." And I went, "Wait, folk instruments, you can always play those." No problem. Much better, problem solved. So I still play it, but not as often as I did as a kid. around 15, I decided the coolest thing in the world would be to lead guitar playing and lead singing. So I was going to be that guy, you know, who could pick up the guitar and do stuff. And my teacher was, she was wonderful. She said, "You've got tons of enthusiasm. That's great. Let's see if we can turn you into a guitar player."
Oh, I know that. I was self-taught all the way up.
I can remember learning the basics from her. I had like 5 lessons, and then we moved. And then I just had a guitar, and I held on to it like it was my identity. But I couldn't play it. And then somewhere in there, I began to practice and play. And I had a couple more lessons, maybe 4 more lessons, and then I just taught myself. And my thing is to teach people who want to learn how to play, how to teach themselves how to play. Because if you can get some fundamentals under your fingers and in your brain, then that can carry you, well, a long ways. Anyway, so that's kind of my story of getting started.
So what brought you all together to Filk?
Well, meeting Margaret and the two of us decided that we would try to hang out together. I was already kind of going to conventions in Filk on the side and just went, "Hey, I get to go to cons. People pay me to go." Well, okay, they don't pay me, but I don't have to pay for a room. This is rocks. This is awesome. And these cons, they're blowing my mind. I have no idea what I'm going to do. It's freedom. It's the greatest. I was just young enough to really feel pure about it. It was great. And I hung out only a little bit with the Filkers. A little bit, and then as time went by, a little bit more, and then as I worked at Off Centaur, I began to go and sit table, and then I had to perform, and I had to see people, and I began to love it, and then I guess that's where the Filk came from. But Margaret and I got together, and we went to a park, I think.
Yeah, well, we started flirting at a Baycon in 1989, so, and I remember you singing the high part on Drivel?
Yeah.
Yeah. On Dr. Jane Robinson's song Drivel. And I was like, "Oh my God, what a cute guy with such an amazing voice, and he plays the guitar and everything." And
I did the drop sound, by the way, the one that the I can't do it because my cheek will hurt, but
yeah.
Something like that. I had to make my cheek hurt.
So I got into Filk through my association with Kristoph. Yeah, and yeah. It's just such a welcoming community, and we have good friends now, in the local Filk community. Our local conventions are consonants, of course. And we are both on the Concom of consonants and have been for a number of years, and Baycon, which is a general science fiction con, but with a really strong Filk track. And actually, PantheaCon for 20 years was also our other local con, and it's sadly over now.
Yeah.
Well, I haven't heard of that con in ages, but now I remember hearing about PantheaCon.
Wow. Yeah.
That was a while.
It tore itself apart, as sometimes these things happen.
We had a nice, strong music track.
Our band Avalon Rising and band Broceleon both played regularly at these conventions. Although, actually, Avalon Rising played Baycon for years and years and years until the band said, "We're really tired of this. We have to carry all our crap into some place. It's thankless." Oh, we would sell all kinds of albums, though.
That was sold out, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, we've been guests of honor at a lot of conventions. It's been wonderful. And we really remember fondly going to the German convention in 2008 and being the Filk guests of honor. And we were the guests of honor in 2001 at the British Filk Con.
That was wonderful.
Boy, we've been guests at Consonants twice, I guess.
And we need to go back to both of those places, because just once I'd like to go to a con in a foreign country where I don't have a cold at the time. So it happened at both conventions. I was like,
"Oh, wonderful.
Right, it's not cool." You know how that goes. Anyway.
I don't want to leave out WesterCon 2018. That was just a height. We were treated the best we've ever been. And we performed 5 concerts. It was wonderful. We were the music guests there.
That was
a lot, a lot of music seems to have come out of Westercon.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Yeah, Westercons are fun. They rock.
Supportive.
I wanted to do another shout-out to Cindy McQuillan, because I think she kind of, she really helped us out. She got us into the scene more and gave us places to play. And if anybody remembers her sitting at a circle, she was always a presence and made sure that everybody was complimented and things went smoothly and in a nice circle. And she just recognized everybody and found something that was important about them or good to say. And she was just, she taught us a lot about how to behave with people. And that's, you know, that's one of the things that Filk really is, to my mind, as a professional musician, I really like about it, is that we can be free to listen to other people and enjoy them and not be critical, you know, and enjoy it and find what's good in it.
And yeah, I think that's the one thing that got me into Filk when I first walked into Mass Filk, and I had just started learning about Filk in 1998. And, you know, I was a novice guitarist and everything else, and I sat down there, and the first meeting I went to, I didn't even bring a guitar. I just wanted to see what this was all about. And then I came and I sang a song the next time, and I just looked around and everybody clapped and everything else. And I said, boy, I did horrible. If people will clap for this, I'm coming back. But, you know, but it was just that welcoming feeling that the whole community has that is really important.
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah.
Accepting and welcoming.
Yeah. That was Cindy's hallmark. She just made sure of that. Hmm. And Colleen Savitsky was that way too.
Yeah.
Just, you know, made sure.
So did you guys have something you wanted to play or anything?
Oh, lots and lots of things.
Yeah, what do you want to do?
Well, there's the list of things we were considering.
Okay.
What do you think?
I don't know.
Well, then let's do this one.
All right, we'll do that one.
You don't know.
All right. So one of the things that perhaps people may not know, or maybe they do and it's all old hat, I don't know, is that when Margaret and I met, I was at the time being put through school by Marion Zimmer Bradley, the fantasy writer. At any rate, Marion thought very highly of us, and one of her birthdays had us commissioned to come up with an album of her settings of Tolkien music. Well, we thought there wasn't enough for an album, so Margaret set a couple, and I set a couple, so this is one that I set that's on the album, The Starlet Jewel, and to this day, I think we're the only American group that ever got permission from the Tolkien estate.
Yeah, that's the important thing. We actually, it took 6 years and much wrangling, but we actually got the official authorization of the estate of J.R.R. Tolkien to release this music commercially. They have a music editor who listens to it and the music that we wrote and that Marion wrote and said, yeah, that sounds like the kind of thing Tolkien probably had in mind for these songs. And we're the only American group. There's a Danish group, there's a Canadian group, and the group in the Netherlands that got permission. And those are the only ones we know of that have official permission from the Tolkien estate to record his actual words.
Yeah.
Wow. Absolutely fantastic.
And an aside, when we had first sung them, we were reading music that Marion had written, and Marion had remembered how the words went and changed some of them, and the estate pointed this out to us.
Said, wow.
You need to fix these words, but we'll still let you make an album. So, I don't know. And they tightened up after that, I think.
So this is one of those.
So this was one of the hot tub songs. I wrote two songs out at the backyard in the hot tub, because everybody should write songs in and around a hot tub. Don't you think? I think so.
Yeah.
I think that's a good idea.
Anyway, so here you go. The Troll Song. Troll sat alone on a seat of stone and munched and mumbled.
Harold Boone. For many years he nodded here, for me it was hard to come by, done by, come by. In a cave in the hills he dealt alone, and meat was hard to come by. Up came Tom with his big two tons, and he to troll. Brain was yawn, for it looks like a shit of my Uncle Tim. I should be lying in the graveyard, caveyard, paveyard. This many years Tim been gone, and I thought he were lying in the graveyard. By lance and troll, this bone I stole, for what me bones and lying all. My knuckle was dead as a lump of lead, afore I found his shin bone, tin bone, tin bone. I ex-parish here for a poor old troll, he don't need his shin bone. Said, tell it on sea with a lax of thee, without asking me to go making free with the shank of the shin of my father's skin. So hand the old bone over, rover, trover. Though that he be, belongs to thee, so hand the old bone over. For a couple of pittances, twirling grins, I'll eat thee too, and gnaw my shins. Bit of fresh meat will go down sweet, I'll try my teeth on thee now, thee now, see now. I'm tired of not old bones and skins, of a mind to dine on thee now. But just as he thought his dinner was caught, his man's hands had hold not before he could mind, Tom slipped behind and gave him a boot to lard him, warn him, darn him. A bumble of beaver, think on thought, would be the way to lard him. But harder than stone is the flesh and bone of a troll that sits in the hills alone. Has one such a boot to the mountain's root, the seed of a troll on feel it, feel it, heal it. Old troll laughed when he heard Tom groan, he knew his toes could feel it. Tom's legs came since home he came, and his bootless boots lasting lame. Troll won't care, and he's still there with a bone that he bone for an owner, donor, boner. Troll's old seed is still the same with a bone that he bone from its owner.
Very good.
So that was very, very. So those are all Tolkien's words.
Yep, that's yeah. Fellowship of the Ring.
Yeah, it sounded very familiar. That's why. So
I did screw some up. So I mean, technically, there were a few words put in there, and some smushed together. Well, you know, you start out at a tempo that seems right. And then you sing. Margaret laughs at me. That's right. But he said that this was written in a certain kind of style. I can't remember the name for it, with the echoing things. And for the life of me, I just could not think of anything to do with it. I just went, this is such a cool thing. I would, you know, this Hobbit songs, they speak to me. I can kind of understand them. In fact, I still think the Hobbit songs are the clearest and the best written of the ones that are in there, with the exception of perhaps of the Elvish, well, the two, the Lay of Nimrodel and Galadriel's Lament, or, well, and actually the Elvish Lullaby too. Mm. Ah, well.
We like them all.
He was good, I guess.
I guess. Well, Tolkien was a fantastic writer, and I've always loved the trilogy, The Hobbit and that. So it's nice to know that you were given permission to do this by the estate. And because, I mean, you guys certainly on that last song complimented very well, very well.
I like to think that at some point deep in the past, I learned this melody from my mom singing it to me when I was a kid.
Oh, that would be neat.
Because when she would read the songs for us kids, and I was the youngest kid, and I demanded that she read it for me, even though she'd read it to each of my older sisters, all three of the books. So that's a determined moms. I made her do it again for me. And all of us kids would sit and we'd hear it the third time, you know. So I'd heard a lot of those, except for when I was naughty and had to go to bed and missed it for, you know, like a chapter anyway. That's oversharing. But she would sing all the songs. She would sing. She would sing the Elvish and sing for us, and she would make them up every time. So, I think there's some possible DNA thing that happened in my head that maybe she fixed it. I don't know.
No, that's what I often say. What is this to my daughters? This is a brain eater starving song.
There you go. There you go.
Yeah, as Mark Mandel says, the meter and rhyme scheme. That's exactly what I finally did. Once you have the meter and rhyme scheme going, you've just unlocked how to do the song. So once I'd worked out a pattern, it was just a case of applying it. And I think it's interesting because of Merry Old Inn, which is another one that I had to work out, has one spot where his words force you to kind of put two otherwise disparate bits of melody together in order to have one phrase work. And in all the other places, the phrases stop at those disparate spots. So they don't go together. But in one spot, he puts them together. So you always have to, as a singer, kind of stick them together while you're singing to make it work. So speaking of meter and rhyme.
Yes. Sometimes you have to sneak that in and, you know, hopefully it slides in from that point.
Yeah.
So how many albums do you actually have out right now?
It depends on how you count them, but 15.
Yeah.
And some of them are with us as a duo. I have one solo, and then we have a number we recorded with our two bands. We have his and hers bands. It's the cutest thing ever.
So why don't you give us a little bit of a rundown on the bands?
Sure.
Okay.
Well, I run Broceliande. Broceliande is a French word that refers to the magic forest in Brittany where Merlin lived and then was caught by the fairy Vivian. Anyway, it's a wonderful word, and it describes our band that at one point was four people, Kristoph and I and two other people. We had all four voice parts covered, and our good friend Chris plays the cello and the nickel harpo, which is very cool and interesting, and sings alto. Carl Franzen is unfortunately passed now, but he was our bass and just a guitar virtuoso.
Yeah.
And played melodeon and what do you call that? Harmonica. Yeah, and Brazilian was started in 99, and we're still going with the trio. We do a combination of Celtic music of Ireland and Scotland, and also medieval and Renaissance music, some madrigals. But we try to give it our own original spin, you know, on these things.
Things that move us.
And we did a whole series of four albums based on music of each of the seasons. So these were pieces that we either traditionally performed in one of the seasons or refer to the season or somehow tie in. So we have Sir Chris Dumas was the first. We had Gathering May for spring, Jig of Life for summer, and Barley Rigs for fall.
Wheel of the Year.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, and the songs truly reflect that on the albums.
And then we did two others on top of that.
Yeah.
So that's my band. I'm the leader. So your band, talk about your band.
I can't resist an aside.
Yeah.
I think one of my favorite aspects of Broceliande is that Talis Kimberley in England really likes the album. Listens to them, you know, and always makes a point of saying something about it. And she's so sweet.
Yeah.
And actually, I'm so impressed by her that if she likes our stuff, that makes me feel like we've done something cool.
I was at the first convention that she came over to the U.S., and she was just fabulous.
Yeah.
She was fabulous.
Yeah, she's one of these real deal people. Yeah.
I'm trying to remember if that was concertino that she came over or if it was OVFF. I'm not sure which one it was. Must have been OVFF.
I can remember her at Consonance.
Yeah, she was a guest at Consonance.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It was a long time ago.
It was back in... I would say 2001, 2002, someplace around there.
Anyway, I like to think that the kind of music that she plays and supports and is into kind of is an interesting parallel with Roséliande and its repertoire. Mm-hmm. And that pleases me.
Oh, and the other tidbit about Roséliande is we all were cast in a Disney movie.
We're
very proud of that. well, that's not quite true. All of us except Carl made it into the Disney movie.
So are you a Disney princess then?
I'm a Disney recorder player. We're in the movie Bedtime Stories. If you ever watch that, there's a scene where it's an Adam Sandler movie. Adam Sandler and everybody else goes to this medieval castle, which is in the Napa Valley, just an hour away.
Oh, wow.
It's filmed there. And we're in the medieval band that plays in this medieval castle.
And there's a moment where they focus on the middle, on the medieval band, and there we are just like 5-6 seconds.
And we got 2 hours of work for that, really short.
Yeah.
I mean, 2 days, not 2 days. Hours,
two days.
Yeah.
The best part was that since we were a music people, we got to have our own air-conditioned
trailer
to be in. We got a trailer. All the other extras had to go out and kind of huddle together in the gigantic jet-like air conditioners where they had set up for the catering. And we got to eat full-on catering, and they had a big close-of-shoot thing where they had people cooking things especially for people.
Lobster.
And chefs and lobsters and steaks, and it's just unimaginable. And we all went nuts because why not?
And I won't really drop names, but these actors and actresses are a lot shorter in real life.
Oh, I'm sure they are. I know.
not just one guy, but somebody else too.
Yeah,
really short.
Well, we didn't actually meet anybody. We didn't meet any of these.
Oh, you know who else was in that? What's his name? The guy who was in Harry Potter.
Yeah.
Mr. Dursley. That actor who plays him was in this movie.
Griffiths.
Yeah.
Michael Griffith?
Richard.
Yes.
Something like that, yeah.
Yeah.
Anyway,
that's
my band.
Yeah, and I won't say anything. But he really liked the catering.
Didn't we all?
We all did.
Right. So about your band. No.
And I have to say, he is as large in person as you think he is on the screen. So... that was a bit off-putting. We're like, oh my goodness, you're huge.
Yeah, you know, some people are the size you see on the screen, but I would say like Patrick Stewart is only like this tall. So,
but he would, you know, he would open up his mouth even at the catering, and just it was so mellifluous. You'd go, okay.
He had a beautiful voice.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's really something. That's a real life voice there. Wow. So anyway, that's all. That's fun. And the other band is Avalon Rising. Besides actually the two of us, we as a duo go play sometimes too. But Avalon Rising is the Celtic rock band. The Celtic rock band is reasserting its original thing, which was to not be Celtic rock, but just to be kind of, mostly music that I've written music. And we're kind of getting back into those roots and keeping all the Celtic stuff that we like, as opposed to doing a bunch of stuff in order to go play at Celtic shows, Celtic fairs. And that's not because it wasn't fun. Mostly we just haven't done them in a while. But Avalon Rising is a five-piece. It should be a five-piece.
We lost one.
We lost one, yeah.
It's a four-piece.
So, but right now it's Margaret plays harp and flute and sings. And sings a lot of the leads, and I play electric guitar and acoustic guitar and sing leads and write a lot of the songs. Mark Ongar is our bass player and general nutcase, wouldn't you say? Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's some sort of nut mutant. And Scott Irwin is our drummer, and we've just been extraordinarily blessed to have Mark and Scott playing for us, because good bands are built on good foundations. And a good drummer and bass player that really know each other and can be in the pocket together will make your night and lift you when you're having problems and struggling. That's very true. And they've done it many times. But I can't resist one more brag about Scott, though.
Okay.
Because Scott is an interesting character. as we've gotten to know Scott, he would come to the conventions and he'd say, where's the Star Trek stuff? And we're like, okay, he's a Star Trek fan. Well, it goes a little further than that. Scott has worked on a whole bunch of really very nice high-end Star Trek YouTube movies where he has done, like, built the phasers and the sets and the little things you press that make the noises and all of them, the communicators. He makes them so they all work and they do their thing. And he has repaired stuff that's in the museum up in Seattle, the Star Trek Museum. So it's just an odd coincidence that here in this Celtic band is this mild-mannered drummer who's a gigantic Star Trek fan and actually builds stuff and repairs things. Repairs stuff that was on the original set. So what a trip.
That is fantastic. And being a Star Trek fan filmmaker myself, I can appreciate where he's coming from. So I have to talk to him.
Well, when we played Worldcon, he had made, you know, when you watch 2001 A Space Odyssey, there's Al is always depicted with a certain kind of looks like a rounded lens of something of some sort. Well, he made one. Only he copied the actual thing. He bought the actual lens that you make it out of, because it's actually a photograph lens, a photographic lens that was used that they adapted for the thing. So he made one. And when we played Worldcon, he had it connected to his drum and blinking so that anybody who looked really hard would go, is that Hal up there? So, and he also dressed as a flying monkey.
From The Wizard of Oz.
A flying monkey.
I love it. Love it.
Flying monkey.
The rest of us are normal people.
Why?
I say that, but Mark is not normal, and none of us are normal.
Normal is just blasé. That's underrated.
Well, and we're hoping Avalon Rising will get rounded out, perhaps by another fiddle player, perhaps by somebody else, or a keyboard player. We don't know yet.
Well, and I have to jump in. One of Avalon Rising's heights was performing in China. We were sent over to the Shandong province, to Jinan, China, to play in the Euro-American Festival. And, everybody there was actually American. There were no Europeans. But they were promoting us all as if we were...
We pretended to be.
Europeans. So they were pretending we were an Irish band. Which we weren't.
Wait, there's more to that story. They said, you're an Irish band, therefore we'll make sure. Do you have kilts? And we said, Irish don't really wear kilts the way you think. You're thinking of the Scots. Like, no, we have to be, it has to be Titanic, they would say to us, because the movie Titanic was out.
Yeah.
And so that was understood, so we went, I see, kilts, fine. They paid for us to have utilikilts. And at the time, utilikilt every month was getting their stuff together, and so they would give an award of a utilikilt to somebody who had worn one and taken a great picture of themselves. So Mark got a picture. Mark and I both got our picture taken in the newspaper, wearing our kilts and lifting our legs up on monitors, which I only did once because a little child looked under my kilt, and I said, "That's never happening again."
So that was just- in the Shanghai newspaper or something, and anyway, he sent Mark sent that in to
utilikilt
and won for the month and got the free kilt.
Yeah, so he has a workman's kilt. Yeah, and he would wear it to go work on stuff. He was a handyman for a while. Avalon Rising has the first album, eponymous rise, is Avalon Rising. The second one is called Storming Heaven, and the third one is called Elbows and Antlers. None of them are short. We do not make short albums. In fact, Elbows and Antlers is like 74 minutes or something.
Woo!
Or I don't know how long it's 70. It's right up there.
Oh, so somebody's asking the actual names of our other ones. Well, there's the self-titled Avalon Rising.
I said that already.
Storming Heaven and Elbows and Antlers. Yeah. Okay, he already said it. Sorry. Well,
Yeah.
And I just wanted to actually, I don't know if this is this backwards or is this legible?
Oh, that's legible. Flowing
glass. That's for people people can buy our CDs. We also have a Patreon, patreon.com/Margaret and Kristoph.
Which is soon going to have a song that Margaret's putting on her next album.
Yeah, I'm making a new album, and we finally got a really glorious version of the Scottish traditional song finished, and that's going to go out to our patrons.
That's right.
Go ahead and go back to the private chat over there and type that in, and I'll post it to the group.
Okay.
You type it.
I can do that. I'll do that. Okay.
Hi, she's typing.
Okay.
She'll be our clandestine
typer. That's right. Type. Oops, how are we going to do this?
You have to move it over there. It's not easy.
It's not easy. Right.
Not easy being a clandestine typist. I'm sorry, it's a Monty Python phrase. It's a reference to Monty Python. I'm sure everybody gets it. Clandestine typing service. I was going to have a form a band called that. Thought it'd be a good band name. Clandestine typing service. What are you? We're a rock and roll band. We can type for you all you want. What would you like typed? We'll be playing tomorrow night. That was my plan.
So where are you playing next, actually?
Well, Kristoph has a gig with his new blues band coming right up.
I have two gigs coming up.
Yeah.
Anybody want to come out to California, you can see us on Sunday in Crockett at Toots Tavern. We're going to be playing with another fun band. I don't know, there comes this point where you've been in a rock band for a long time, and you've hung out with other people, and after a while, you all know each other, and you just... Even if you don't play in bands together, you just know who each other are. And so this other one is the High Card Drifters. And this is made up of bands of people we know from all kinds of other bands. In fact, I even recorded a bunch of them in our studio once. So I recorded A Noon once in our studio, which was a gas, if anybody remembers. A shout out to Leon Hussey and company.
He's recorded Shannon McGuire.
Two of her albums.
He produced two of her albums.
And as soon as this COVID thing gets a little bit more under control, she's going to come down and finish a third.
Yeah, that'd be great. Yeah. Brasseleon has a bunch of gigs in December. For some reason, we're associated in a lot of people's minds. What are you trying to do, dear?
Go back to comments.
Okay. With Christmas. So we'll have a big gig in Mountain View, California. And a couple others, private gigs. We don't have much on the virtual Filk scene or live Filk scene for a while, actually. Not until 2023 when we'll be guests at CocoCon.
So anybody wants us as a guest? Hey. We want to go.
Let's see. I know I've got one going. I don't know if I can add the other one. Ah, there we go.
Hey.
Yeah, they're scrolling at the bottom. That's the first time I realized that was there. I know. I mean, we've been using this for a while, but I really have to sit down and listen and work a little bit more on this. Okay, so you guys have another one for us?
Yeah.
Let's do that.
Let's do one of Cindy's songs here.
Yeah.
We're keeping her music alive. She deeded all of her copyrights to us that she had written. Wrote over 1,000 songs, so there's a lot of
material there. A lot of songs we don't know what the tunes are. I'm going to have to check my tuning again. This is what I was doing when we... So this is one of my instruments you can't see. This is my wonderful citern, octave, mandolin, whatever you want to call it.
These are all recorders. I've studied recorder very, very, very seriously, actually with the world's finest recorder player, Marianne Verbruggen, for a while, and also with Eileen Hadidian, but a lot of people just think it's something kids play, but
there's
actually real music written for the recorder.
I was that guy the first time I heard you play. I went, oh my goodness, that's beautiful. That's a sound I don't think I've ever really heard. And then I realized, no, I've been hearing it for years on the radio. In classical music, I just, you know, had not connected it. Because there's a lot of Bach that has recorder in it. I'm just saying, I was connected more to Bach. Okay. Okay. All right. So this was a big rock and roll number. It's on the first Avalon Rising album.
Yeah.
Yeah. And it kicks butt, too. It's a great song. It's a great version of it.
Would you like to let the audience know what you're playing for an instrument?
Well, this is a kind of octave mandolin. It's I'm lucky to have this thing. This was made in 1980 by a fellow named Michael Hubbard, who lives in Mendocino now and makes Elian pipes. So this was a foray into kind of a thick-bodied sort of octave mandolin or cittern, and I've got it tuned like a cittern in that it has like an Irish bouzouki, basically, because it's got these octave strings down here.
Yeah, I wasn't sure what it was. I thought it was a bouzouki, but I couldn't quite tell.
It's an Irish bouzouki.
Yeah,
cittern was kind of had gone out of use, but fell back into use by the, I can't remember the name of the maker now, the great maker.
I don't know.
I forget. Sobel.
Oh.
He made them for Donna Lunny. And they're fat like this. And that's why this has this big roar.
Yeah, I like the sound of that.
I vastly prefer it to almost anybody else's. Not many people have them that sound this fat and rich. And they're not interested in that, I think. They like the lower string action, and it gets all sticky, and I don't know. There's a whole style of accompanying people in Irish music with guitars and stuff where it's a lot of sticky stuff. You're just kind of good a lot. And I think unless you're fantastic, that's just boring. So, but, you know, that's just my taste. But I was lucky enough to play with Carl Friends, and when he would do something on Celtic music, you would stand back in awe and go, okay, that's the best accompaniment for that is maybe possible. And then he'd do another verse and you'd go, that was even better. Then he'd do another verse and you'd go, every one of these was different. How are you? Wow, you're good. So he was an astonishing musician.
Well, we're coming up on the top of the hour. Did you guys have one more that you wanted to sing us out with?
I think you should do that one.
Okay.
Another one Kristoph wrote.
Well, the pandemic was very good to me in that I wrote a lot of songs. In fact, during the pandemic, I think I wrote more songs than I had written up to that point. I mean that I want to perform. I've written a lot of things that I will never perform for anybody, some of which, thank goodness, I've lost the lyrics to.
That might be a good album. It would be songs I don't want anybody else to listen to.
Yeah, exactly. Well, Mark and I were going to put out, Mark Ungar, my bass player, we were going to put out an album of music played on instruments that can't be played.
I like that.
We thought that'd be a good idea. I have to reinvent the wheel here. No. There we go. This is called, what do we call it? Do we call
it that? I'm a retriever.
It's not called that there, is it?
Yes.
It's just a dumb name up there. I'm a retriever is what it's called.
It's your song.
I've been chasing tennis balls in fairy tales. No one's throwing tennis balls for me. All of them were given to other dogs, it seems. Tennis balls have haunted all my dreams. And I licked her face. Now I'm a retriever. Come to trace the ball of my mind. I'm in love. I'm a retriever. I couldn't leave her if I tried. I thought love was more or less a chasing thing. The more I ran, the more she threw. Oh, yeah! What's the use in trying? You throw the ball again. You get the ball in sunshine or in rain. Then I licked her face. Now I'm a retriever. Gonna chase the ball in my mind. I'm in love. Ooh, I'm a retriever. I can linger if I try. What's the use in trying to throw a ball again? Get the ball in sunshine or in rain. Ooh, then I licked her face. Now I'm a retriever, gonna chase the ball every time. I'm in love. I'm a retriever. I can leave her if I try. Then I licked her face. I'm a retriever, gonna chase the ball in my mind. I'm in love. I'm a retriever, I can leave her if I try.
all I could say is, can I have the lyrics for that and permission to do that on this side of the coast?
Oh, yeah. Oh, sure.
My five dogs would love it.
That came about because of a good friend here in the Bay Area who's a Celtic musician named Autumn Rhodes. She actually travels all over the country. She's, I think, in New York State right now.
Wow.
But she at one point said, didn't he write that thing? That didn't Neil Diamond write that song for the monkeys? What was it? I'm a retriever. She said that as a joke. And then I just came up with the rest of it. It was, I'm a retriever. Thank you. Anyway.
All right. Well, thanks, Frank. This has been amazing.
You've had a ball.
Yes, it's been really fantastic. Thank you guys both for coming on. Donna says, yeah, she likes that. Even though she's got her cat up there, you know, we've got five dogs. But yeah, no, thank you very much for coming on. When things start picking up again and you guys are out more and want to do some more promoting, you know, next year, you know, as things go, I'd love to have you back on.
That'd be fun.
That'd be good.
That'd be fun. Yeah. All right.
That's great. So, everybody, check out their Patreon, check out their flowingglass.com, and get their albums, because I certainly am going to look at getting a couple. Do you have just CDs, or do you have any downloadables?
They're downloads.
They're all downloads, yeah. Yeah.
Good.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. Good. I will be perusing that. So,
yes, they are.
Yeah. So.
All right.
But thank you. Okay. So once again, thank you all for showing up tonight. And for those people catching this on the repeat, please pass it around. Let people know about this. If you're new to the channel, we don't do this for money. We do this for fun. None of our channel, No Budget Productions, Filk Fair Productions, is monetized. So we just have fun. We just, you know, present things to you out there that we, you know, Star Trek, Filk, whatever. So that's what we do. So everybody have a wonderful night. Thank you for coming. Margaret, Kristoph, have a great rest of the week, and take care, everybody.
Yes. Bye-bye.